good morning, happy Tuesday, and happy anniversary as well. It is the fourth year in office, almost to the day, for Baltimore's City Inspector General, Isabel Mercedes Cumming, who joins us here on the C4 and Bryan Nehman Show. Good to have you on, and congratulations.
Yep.
Oh, thank you so much. Do you know what's the interesting thing, Bryan?
What?
Four-year anniversary. I am now the longest-serving inspector general in history in Baltimore.
Wow.
There's only been five. 4 years make me the longest.
There you go.
Well, very good. Well, long live the inspector general, as far as I'm concerned.
Not that they haven't tried, but we'll get to that.
Because I'm obviously, as people well know, a huge fan of this position. I think it's been one of the most impactful things the government has done in the last, decade or so around here. But as you reflect on 4 years in office, give us a sense of where you think the position has gone, what you have seen in those 4 years.
Well, I believe there's been a tremendous amount of awareness for the position. I mean, with all the great things Kelly Madigan is doing in Baltimore County, what's happening throughout the state, it's really making people aware that inspector generals are hopefully here to stay and that the independence of them is so important. I really believe this is an office that is truly for the citizens and for the voters, and it is an office that is powered, I should say, by the people, because it's the hotline that we get all our tips from the citizens. And that's why it has been so effective. And having people like you and C4 and just the outreach that people learn what this office is has made the tremendous difference. And there's a whole lot more that has to be done, too.
I'm sorry. We're speaking with Isabel Cumming. She is the four-year now, as you heard, serving Inspector General for the City of Baltimore, even though the specific six-year term that she's in, Bryan, was created through legislation. The Baltimore City voters voted on creating this position and having the autonomy that she has now. If you can, for a moment, and we'll get to specifics of kind of what you've been doing with the office, you are now part of the leadership of the National Inspector Generals. You guys got together. Talk about just this position, because Bryan and I are also just interested in the position of Inspector General. Why is this important as an arm of government?
Oh, it's very important. It is sometimes it's a way for people on, because as an inspector general, you are independent. So it's an opportunity to look at how the practices are happening, because most inspector generals have an audit arm, an evaluations arm, and an investigations arm. When I started, we moved forward on the investigations arm. However, the law says we can also do evaluations, and that is one thing that we hope to in the future. But this position allows citizens to let, if they see something that is not right, they have a hotline that they can call. There's whistleblower protection. We're really trying to let the citizens have an opportunity to have somebody that will investigate for them. And it's not somebody that's tied to anybody else in government. And I think that's what's made such a difference with this position and with Kelly Madigan and with all of them. I think that has been probably the biggest difference.
Where are your main tips coming from? Are they coming from citizens? Are they coming from employees? Are they coming from contractors? Like, who is calling you and who is giving you, the biggest tips, if you will, for investigations that you've performed, especially the ones where you've found wrongdoing?
Honestly, all of the above. We get a tremendous amount from employees, because when you start working here in Baltimore City, I actually talk to all the new employees and give them a card telling them about the office. Tremendous amount have come in from citizens. We have had many come in from contractors. And then we also we get calls just from people that are frustrated because they can't get any other people to call them back. And so we also try to direct people in the correct ways of where to go.
Isabel Cumming is on board with us, Inspector General for the City of Baltimore. And if you can, you know, we have your annual reports that we get each year, you know, talking about the waste, fraud, and abuse that you've been able to uncover. But over 4 years, I was watching you talk about this in another media entity. Just talk about, you know, just what you've been able to at least identify through those 4 years, if you can.
Sure. We were just, it's over a little over 12 million. We have done investigations involving IT, Department of Transportation, Health, Procurement, DPW, Police, Fire, things such as policies have changed, such there's a policy that changed with police overtime, impacting in that sometimes we had cases where people, you know, there was a news article that wasn't 100% correct, and we do an investigation, and two people have their job saved. So it can run the gamut. I mean, we do almost every type of case that involves city government and monies that go out to. So we're really watching the money. We're the watchdog for the citizens of their tax money, which it's a tremendous responsibility. But I have an incredible team that really believes the mission of, you know, following the complaints, following the investigations, and then most importantly, letting the citizens know what we've done. Transparency, making sure that, you know, we publish our reports, we make sure that we notify all the media that things come out so that people know that, you know, we're trying to get things done for them.
Well, look at the Board of Estimates, what you're able to do with the conflicts of interest, you know, making them mm-hmm. more transparent with their votes. I think that was very important, Inspector General.
Thank you. Thank you. And now I also have the, under our wing is also the ethics, the whole ethics department too. And like yesterday, all the elected officials in Baltimore City had to turn in their ethics disclosures, which will be available for if the public wants to look at them on the ethics website, and really trying to make sure that citizens know where to find things. Even on the OIG website, we have just a call section of, you know, if it's something like you have a social security problem, who do you call, and just trying to let people know how to maneuver government.
How would you describe the cooperation with the different government agencies when you are doing an investigation?
We have lots of partners, and I do think that's important. None of us can do this as an island. And even within the city, if I have to do an investigation, for the most part, everybody is very cooperative, because in the end, we're trying to make the best Baltimore we can have. And there's so many great employees in Baltimore City that want that to happen, that we really don't have a problem with, you know, oh my God, it's the OIG, don't speak to them. No, that does not happen.
Okay.
Isabel Cumming, Inspector General, is on board with us. And look, you're a former prosecutor. You came out of State Special Prosecutor's mm-hmm. Office. So mm-hmm. I know that you're going to maintain, you know, not discussing certain things. However, when you were asked, when you were requested to look into Baltimore City State Attorney Marilyn Mosby's travel and that type of thing, it seemed to us, Bryan and myself, that's when some of the issues regarding your office came into view and some of the ratcheting of politics turned up. Do you feel right now that you're in a good place in your office in terms of what you need to do?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, my office has, since that one particular case, we've done about 12 other investigations that have been published. My office does what they're asked to do, and then we move forward. I mean, we are not lacking. At this present moment, we have 38 investigations ongoing, and we have a pending list. So we have to keep moving forward. And if it made the office people more aware of the office, you know, I have no problem with that. When I first came here, I told people that one out of every 25 people I stopped would know what an IG is. I'd like to think now that it's more like 8 or 9. So okay, we're getting there. We still have a ways to go, and that's what makes it fun.
Very good.
Another thing I'm going to be doing, we're going to be having a Citizens Academy starting soon, so that citizens can actually come here and learn about how we do things.
So citizens can sit in there and watch, or you...
No, they can't watch. No. But we're going
to. Because I was going to volunteer for that.
They actually do it at the different agencies that I like. They have it at the OIG in Louisiana, and they have it at some of the sheriff's departments. That you actually have an academy where leaders in the community can actually come, and you know, we'll actually sit down, talk, and we'll actually see how we do things, so that they can almost get out in the community and let more people know how it's done.
Very good. Is there anything you need, or there's anything that you are concerned about as per the job?
What I do hope in the future is that we are able to establish the evaluations program, because sometimes we do investigation after investigation into a particular area, and not always is it changed. So I think having an evaluations group that is more instead of being reactive, which is what my investigation is, we can be proactive and try to offer the ability to make things better processes within, because in order to do the evaluations, you would, of course, be trained as a certified inspector general evaluator. And it would be an opportunity, again, to work together to make things better for the city. That's my goal.
Are you comfortable at this point where this oversight board that was created through the charter, we voted on this, are you comfortable where this board is in terms of your functions, your day-to-day functions? Are you okay with that?
Oh, no, not at all. In order to have an independent inspector general, you need to have an independent board. So I will continue to put forth that the advisory board of the inspector general should not be people that are under the investigation of the inspector general, and instead should be the citizens of Baltimore City. And that is the way it is throughout the rest of, you know, the country. Best practices are exactly that. And I will always fight for Baltimore to have best practices and the best it can be. And the way it's set up now is not that.
Right. And in order for that to happen, that has to come from the city council, a law?
No.
How does that have to happen?
Well, I think the way it would happen is if we have 10,000 signatures on a ballot amendment and so it would have to happen in this November of 22. It would have to be a charter amendment to change it. And in order to be on the charter, they would have to have 10,000 signatures that people want that to happen. And I think it was we were all, including myself, arguing for independence for the inspector general. Nobody really, including myself, paid attention to who was on this advisory board. And what's concerning is this advisory board is, you know, five individuals that are, according to the law, it's the mayor, or the designee, the mayor, the city council president, the comptroller, the city solicitor, and a council person. All of those people are in the political realm. You do not want an inspector general to be in the political realm. So that's and my term does end in 2 years and 10 months. So when my term ends, it is that group of five individuals that will be picking the next inspector general, unless the law changes and the citizens change that so the advisory board is made more independent. So I do think it's a very important issue.
We will be on that. Brian and I will definitely talk more about that without you here. But finally, Inspector General Isabel Cumming, as you look at 4 years now into this office, we know that you have talked a lot about your counterpart in Baltimore County, Kelly Madigan, mm-hmm. who we've had on the show as well. She does, with one person, an amazing work. I mean, if you can talk about how important it is to have a staff, you have people to assist you. She's basically operating with a shoestring budget.
It's outrageous. If Kelly Madigan has, I think, $300,000 a year. Okay, there's 800,000 people in Baltimore County.
Incredible.
Okay, I only have 550, yet I have a staff of 18. Montgomery County has a staff of 18. Even the education, he has a staff of, I believe, 12. All of us, because there's only four inspector generals in the state of Maryland, all of us have 10 times her budget. So if you want to have an effective inspector general, you cannot have it set up the way that Kelly Madigan is set up. I have the utmost respect for her. She has done an unbelievable job with what she has. And, I mean, she's incredible. She's incredible.
You.
And that needs to change.
Well,
they need to give her more money.
We'll be on that when County Executive Johnny O joins us. We'll ask him about that. Thank you so much.
And thank you all so much. Thank you all so much.
Good to have you on. Appreciate your time. And congratulations again as well.
Thank you.
Four years in the job, Bryan. 4 years in the job.
It's really an important position. And I agree with you that it needs to be beefed up to make sure that it is fully independent. But even so, without that, I think it's been a tremendous asset to citizens in Baltimore.